land.
Let my people go.
Oppressed so hard they could not stand.
Let my people go.
So the Lord said, go down.
Go down.
Moses.
Moses.
Way down.
Down
in Egypt land. Tell old Pharaoh to let my people go.
Let my people go.
So Moses went to Egypt land.
Let my people go.
He made old Pharaoh understand.
Let my people go.
Yes, the Lord said, go down.
Go down.
Moses.
Moses.
Way down.
Down
in Egypt land. Tell him. To let my people go.
Let my people go.
Thus spoke the Lord, bold Moses said,
let my people go.
If not, I'll smite your firstborn dead.
Let my people go.
The Lord said, go down.
Go down.
Moses.
Moses.
Way down.
Down
in Egypt land. Tell old Pharaoh
to let my people go.
Good morning, and welcome to our service of morning prayer, coming to you from Grace Episcopal Church in Glendora, California. My name is Susan Scranton. I am rector of the parish, and it truly is my privilege to welcome you to worship this morning. Today is the sixth Sunday after Pentecost, and we have a very special service for you, a morning prayer service adapted to bring to you the highlights of our recent virtual vacation Bible school. It's a service of the kids, by the kids, and for all of you. Created, directed, and delivered by Heather Moore, this has to have been the most fun vacation Bible school I have ever attended. You see, I too got to participate. I too received a box, a big box of goodies, and inside the box, there were five smaller boxes, one for each day. You see, this was not an ordinary VBS or even an ordinary virtual VBS. Each day, the kids spent maybe 5 to 6 minutes viewing a video that detailed the story of Moses, as was told by his sister, Miriam. But inside the box, there were puzzles, there were crafts, there were stories, there were scavenger hunts, there were secret codes, there were secret words, because this vacation Bible school was based upon an escape room. If you go into an escape room today, you have to figure out all the puzzles and all the clues to get out. Well, Moses and his people had to figure out all of the clues and all of the orders by God in order to escape from Egypt. Well, now, each of the kids took those secret words and secret codes and wrote them down in a book. And at the end of the week, they had the words that would allow them to escape with Moses. Coming from Open Your Ears, the first one was, God has spoken to his people. Alleluia. And his words are words of wisdom. Alleluia. And the second one was, go down, Moses, and tell old Pharaoh to let my people go. Just to add some more fun, Heather has created for you a link that will take you to some of the stories, some of the games, some of the puzzles, and you too can have an experience of VBS Moses style. You'll find that link in the email that was sent to you for the service, and you will also find it on our webpage. For now, I invite you now to turn to the experts, Evie Palpant and April Moore, who will tell you about Vacation Bible School.
Okay, Evie, what's something important that Moses did?
He helped other people escape from the king.
The king of what? Remember what country?
Egypt,
that's right. Great.
This year's VBS was about Moses and how he helped the Israelites escape Egypt. That's why it had an escape room theme. This year's VBS was very, very fun. Basically, you got a big box delivered to your door with a bunch of smaller boxes inside. Those boxes are locked. There's one for each day of the week, so 5 boxes. And inside of those boxes are a bunch of fun crafts, but also puzzles that help you find certain words. And then at the end of the week, those words come together to spell out some song lyrics.
Please join me now in singing Open Your Ears. Join me now in the invitatory. Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
A reading from Exodus, the birth of Moses. The story of Moses and how God used him to rescue the Israelites from captivity in Egypt and lead them to the promised land properly begins with Abraham, the father of the chosen people. For it was to Abraham and his descendants that God made a covenant with his chosen people to give them land, prosperity, and be their God. Abraham and Sarah had Isaac. Isaac and Rebekah had Jacob and Esau, and Jacob had 12 sons, the most famous of which was Joseph. It was Joseph who, through some nefarious aims of his brothers and through God's providence, ended up in Egypt. In Egypt, Joseph helped Pharaoh and Egypt weather a severe famine that touched much of the Middle Eastern world. When Joseph's brothers and his father Isaac came to Egypt seeking food, they were served by Joseph. In gratitude for all that Joseph had done to save Egypt, Pharaoh invited Joseph's entire family to move to Egypt. And that is how the chosen people ended up in Egypt, where they flourished and grew in numbers. Many years later, Pharaoh and his descendants died, and along came a new Pharaoh, who didn't like it that there were so many Hebrew people, otherwise known as Israelites, living in Egypt, foreigners in his land. He decided to enslave them and became crueler each day. Slave drivers beat the Hebrews unmercifully, goading them to make more bricks and to work faster. Nonetheless, the Israelites continued to grow in number, making Pharaoh even angrier. Then one day, Pharaoh gave a terrible order to the midwives who helped deliver the Hebrew babies. You are to kill all baby boys as you are helping to deliver them. But the midwives honored God and they refused to follow Pharaoh's orders, lying to Pharaoh by telling him that the Hebrew women were so strong that they gave birth before the midwives arrived. Exasperated, Pharaoh took his order one step further. He ordered all the baby boys born to Hebrew women to be thrown into the Nile River and drowned. It was during this time that Moses was born. For several months, his mother hid him from Pharaoh's soldiers. But as he grew and became louder, she knew she had to do something. So she got a little basket boat made of papyrus, waterproofed it with tar and pitch, and placed the child in it. Then she set it afloat in the reeds at the edge of the Nile. His sister Miriam followed at a distance to see what would happen. As the basket reached the edge of Pharaoh's compound, Pharaoh's daughter was bathing in the river. She saw the basket, opened it, and found a crying baby. She said, "This must be one of the Hebrew babies," and she instantly fell in love with him and decided to adopt him. Miriam was watching all of this, and she came up to Pharaoh's daughter and asked her, "Do you want me to go and get Hebrew mothers to nurse the baby for you?" "Of course," she said, "and I will pay you." So Moses' own mother nursed the baby Moses. After he was weaned, she presented him to Pharaoh's daughter, and Moses grew up in the home of Egyptian royalty. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Wow, that's quite a story, isn't it? We had all kinds of activities that went along with it. Moses floating down the river. And yet another one of Moses in that basket. It's a wonderful story of God's providence, of belief, of hope, of trust, and of God using God's people to accomplish his purposes. Think of all the people that helped out, particularly the women, Pua and Shipra. They were the Hebrew midwives that trusted in God instead of Pharaoh and defied Pharaoh's orders. And then there was Moses' mother, who unselfishly gave Moses up for adoption so that he could survive and thrive and become God's spokesman. And then there was Miriam, Moses' sister, who followed along to protect him as he floated down the river, making sure that his true mother was the one who would nurse him. Well, it was all part of God's plan to save his chosen people, to rescue them from the hands of Pharaoh in Egypt.
A reading from Exodus, the burning bush. One day as Moses was tending the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, he came near the mountain of God. And there he saw a strange sight. A bush was on fire, but it was not burning up. As he got closer to the sight, he thought to himself, "This is weird. I wonder why the bush doesn't burn up." While he was pondering that, he heard a voice calling, "Moses! Moses!" And Moses said, "Here I am." "Do not come any closer. Take off your sandals, for the ground on which you are standing is holy ground. I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." When Moses heard this, he turned his face away. He was afraid to look at God. But God said, "Moses, listen to me. I have seen my people suffer in Egypt. I have heard them cry out because of their slave drivers. And so I have come down to rescue them from the Egyptians. I will bring my people out of Egypt into a country where there is good land, rich with milk and honey. My people have begged for help, and I have seen how cruelly they are being treated by the Egyptians. It is time for you to go back. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the people of Israel, out of Egypt." Moses responded, "What? Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and lead your people out of Egypt?" And God responded, "I will be with you, and I will give you a sign. When you bring my people out of slavery, they will worship me on this mountain." Then Moses said to God, "Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your ancestors has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' Then what should I tell them?" 'I am who I am.' That is what you should say to the Israelites. 'I am has sent me to you.' Tell them that the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob sent me to you. This has always been my name, and this is how I always will be known. Now go." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
A burning bush that didn't burn up. Here you go. And maybe you like this one. That bush is burning, but not burning. Can you imagine being called by God? Can you imagine instead of Moses, you heard Susan, Richard, Heather, April, "Take off your sandals. You are standing on holy ground, and I have a mission for you." The truth is, each of us have been called by God. We were first called at our baptism, and then commissioned, called to be God's people doing God's work as teachers or as lawyers or as doctors or as nurses, any number of occupations in which each of you represent God and each of you bring God's peace, God's love to a hurting world.
The third lesson from Exodus, the plagues. The next day, Moses and his brother Aaron went to Pharaoh and said to him, The God of Israel says to you, let my people go. As Moses feared, Pharaoh uttered a resounding no and said, because you have angered me, your people, my slaves, will now have to search the hills and get their own straw to make bricks, and they will make the same number of bricks as before. Moses and Aaron left discouraged. The Israelite slaves worked even harder while scorning Moses for making things worse. Moses asked God, why? But God sent Moses and Aaron back to Pharaoh to demand release of the chosen people. In God's power, they turned their staffs into snakes, but Pharaoh's magicians did the same thing. It was no contest, but at least Moses' snake swallowed up all of the magician's snakes, and Pharaoh's heart remained hard. After that, God used Moses to bring upon Egypt and Pharaoh a series of 10 plagues. All the water in rivers, lakes, and streams turned to blood. Then God brought upon the Egyptians a plague of frogs, and then gnats, and then flies. The plague on the livestock of the Egyptians was particularly bad, as all of their animals died while the animals of the Israelites were spared. But Pharaoh's heart continued to be hard. So God sent a plague of boils, and then hail that destroyed all the crops. And then there were locusts, and then darkness over all the land for 3 whole days. And the final plague, the death of the firstborn of people and animals, from the son of Pharaoh to the son of his slave. But God would protect the Israelites with the blood of the Lamb. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Wow, the 10 plagues. They must have been something else. And Heather created this very special visual for each of you. For there you see, the first one is blood, and then frogs everywhere, and then gnats, ick, and flies. Ugh. Plague on the poor animals, and boils with huge blisters everywhere. Hail, it hit so hard that it destroyed all of the crops. Locusts buzzing around and eating everything. And then there was darkness. Darkness for 3 whole days. And finally the last one, the death of the firstborn. Well, I am going to invite you to hear Sophie Moreno as she talks about the plagues.
The 10 plagues.
What about the 10 plagues?
They caused major problems around.
And whose fault was that?
The Pharaoh's.
Yeah. Okay. Sophie, what was your favorite part? What did you enjoy?
Mostly. The 10 plagues.
You enjoyed learning about them?
Mm-hmm.
How come?
Because I wanted to.
Okay. Tell, what do you have there in your hand? Can you tell us about your craft?
Mm-hmm.
Now you're shy. All right. Tell Miss Heather thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, campers. Miriam here. And have I got a story to tell you today. It was right after the 9th plague, the plague of darkness for 3 days, that God came to Moses and said, listen to me. I'm going to give you the last plague, instructions for Passover, and I'm going to tell you how you are going to be freed. Well, my brother and God talked a long time. And then Moses came out and said, gather all the Hebrew families. I have an important message from God. This is what's going to happen. About midnight, the angel of death is going to pass over all of the homes of the Hebrews and the Egyptians and kill the firstborn son of Pharaoh, the firstborn son of a maid, the firstborn of animals, all shall die and there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. But you, my Hebrew people, my chosen people, will all be spared. And all of your children shall live. And oh my gosh, we heard those words and we bowed down and says we worship the Lord. And then Moses said, I have more instructions for you. At twilight, each family needs to go out and kill a Passover lamb. And then you are to take the blood of that lamb and put it in a bowl and take a hyssop branch, put it in the bowl, and I need you to take that blood and put it all along the doorposts of your door, across the top, and down the other side as well. Then roast the lamb. That'll take a little bit while. And then I want you to eat that lamb with unleavened bread and bitter herbs and make sure you're ready to go. Have your clothes on, have everything packed, have your children ready, and we're going to be ready to go out that door. You see, when the angel of death comes, that angel will pass over all of the homes that have the blood of the Passover lamb on it. They shall live. And those homes that do not have it, the firstborn, shall die. God has asked us to remember this day forever as Passover. We're to remember it when we get into the promised land. We're to remember it from those descendants, and on it shall be remembered forever as a day that God rescued us, the Passover. We all told Moses we would do it. So accordingly, my father went out and he killed a lamb and he got the blood. I even have some of it here so that you can see what it looks like. He did that. And then he took that blood, he got a hyssop branch like this, put it in the blood, and put the blood on the door, atop the door, and down the other side. And that blood sure is a remembrance of something important happening, and it sticks to my fingers as well. Campers, your secret word is his. After we did that to the door, my mom cooked the lamb over the fire and we roasted it. It was pretty late by the time it was done. She'd already started to make sure that the bread would rise too. And then came the sound. There was wailing and there was weeping and there was crying and we knew what had happened. And then God sent for Moses and Aaron and said, you people, get out of here. Take all of your people and get out. Go. And so the alarm sounded. We weren't even finished eating. The bread hadn't risen. It didn't matter. Moses said, we have to go. And we have to go now. And so we did. It was the way to freedom. It was the most wonderful thing in the whole wide world. We were going to freedom. And God didn't want to take us near the Philistines because there might be war. So instead, we went through the desert and we started out for the Red Sea. Ah, it was glorious. We traveled for a while. And to protect us, God gave us a pillar of fire to lead us at night and a pillar of cloud to lead us during the daytime. And they did such a good job. But then we looked. Pharaoh had changed his mind again. He was worried that he was going to lose all of his slaves, so he came after us with 600 chariots, a bunch of other chariots, horsemen, you can't imagine it, and they were faster than us because they were in chariots. And we saw them just down there, and we cried out to Moses, oh, Moses, don't let us die here in the desert. And Moses cried out to God, and God said, Moses, you're going to be fine. Take your staff. And he took his staff. And as they got to the Red Sea, God said, put your staff across the water. And the most amazing thing happened. The sea parted. And we walked across it on dry land. And in the meantime, the pillar of fire and the pillar of smoke had so stirred up the chariots that their wheels got stuck in the mud and they couldn't go anywhere. We crossed on dry land. And then God said to Moses, take your staff again and touch it. And the sea closed in on all those Egyptians who were chasing us. And they all died, and we were safe and finally on our way to the promised land. I was so happy. I even wrote a song, and it's in the Bible. Thanks be to God, all the horsemen, all the chariots drowned in the sea. We are safe. Ah, the last plague, Passover, the parting of the Red Sea. Boy, was that fun. The events of Passover, something that God's people would remember forever and ever, is stock and part of Jewish life today. It's probably the most important event that marks the Hebrew people, the Jewish people, as God's people. We even remember it often during Holy Week, remembering that it was God's first big salvation plan. Well, while they did that, it was the pillar of fire and the pillar of clouds that led the people of Israel. And then when they got close to the Red Sea, they were the ones that so disturbed Pharaoh and all of his chariots that they got all messed up and allowed the people to move on. Well, I'm going to turn now to David Moore, and he's going to tell you all about that pillar of fire and pillar of cloud.
Okay, for VBS, we made some special desserts. A pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire in the Red Sea that was parted. For VBS, we made a pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire, and they were made out of marshmallows and fruit roll-ups, and the Red Sea was made of graham crackers and frosting.
A reading from Exodus, Wandering in the Wilderness. Finally, the Israelites were free. They left the shores of the Red Sea and headed into the desert of Shur. For 3 days, they traveled in the desert without finding any water. And when they finally spotted water in Marah, the water was bitter and they couldn't drink it. They complained to Moses, who cried out to God. Then God showed Moses a piece of wood and told him to throw it into the water, and the water became sweet, and the people drank. This was the first time they complained to Moses, but it would not be the last time. However, God had made a covenant with his chosen people and would care for them for the entire 40 years that they wandered in the wilderness. When there was no food, God rained down manna from heaven. It was a little like coriander seed in honey. It could be baked, boiled, or rolled together. Every morning, it appeared like dew on the ground, and the people could take and eat as much as they wanted for the day. But they could not save it until the next day, or they would find that it had turned to worms. On the day before the Sabbath day, the instructions were to take twice as much manna as needed and prepare it for that day and the next day, so that on the Sabbath they could rest. God also provided quail and enough water, and the clothes on their backs and the sandals on their feet never wore out. 3 months after the Israelites left Egypt, they came to Mount Sinai. It would be on that mountain that God would give them the Ten Commandments, along with other instructions on how to live and how to worship. God called Moses to come up to the top of the mountain, where he remained for 40 days. And God said, "Here are the commandments that I give you. You shall have no other gods but me. You shall not worship anyone or anything but me. Always use my name respectfully. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not lie. You shall not covet. For the next 40 years, the Israelites wandered in the wilderness until they came into the promised land. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Wandering. The Ten Commandments. Ten Commandments, something that we remember to this day. And I've often thought, if everyone followed the Ten Commandments, what a wonderful world we would have. Well, during those 40 years of wandering, the Hebrew people, the Jewish people, became a people of God. They learned what it meant to be God's people. I invite you now to listen to the reflections of some of our VBS kids as they tell you about their experience. Please listen to McKenna, Lily, Addie, Colin, and Evie.
What I liked about VBS was that we didn't know what we were going to do each day because we had to figure out how to unlock the boxes with activities we get to do. My favorite activity was the burning bush. It was really fun and I enjoyed it.
One, two, go.
My favorite part, the puppy completed, he was a human messages. My favorite part was building Moses.
Go.
My favorite part was cracking the code and unlocking the boxes.
Tell me about something that you learned in VBS this year.
I learned how to make baby Moses in a basket out of stickers.
You did? That's great.
It's like really fun, and I like it so much. Thank you.
Please join me now in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please join me in suffrages A. Your response are the words that are in bold. Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Clothe your ministers with righteousness. Let your people sing with joy. Give peace, O Lord, in all the world, for only in you can we live in safety. Lord, keep this nation under your care and guide us in the way of justice and truth. Let your way be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and sustain us with your Holy Spirit. Let us pray. O Lord, mercifully receive the prayers of your people who call upon you, and grant that they may know and understand what things they ought to do, and may also have grace and power faithfully to accomplish them. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Heavenly Father, in you we live and move and have our being. We humbly pray you so to guide and govern us by your Holy Spirit, that in all the cares and occupations of our life, we may not forget you, but may remember that we are ever walking in your sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers, which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. O God, you have made us in your own image and redeemed us through Jesus, your Son. Look with compassion on the whole human family. Take away the arrogance and hatred which infect our hearts. Break down the walls that separate us, unite us in bonds of love, and work through our struggle and confusion to accomplish your purposes on earth, that in your good time, all nations and races may serve you in harmony around your heavenly throne, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O God of peace, who has taught us that in returning in rest we shall be saved, in quietness and strength shall be our strength. By the might of your Spirit, lift us, we pray, to your presence, where we may be still and know that you are God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now please say with me the birthday and anniversary prayer, and don't forget to put yourself in if you're celebrating. Watch over your children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts, may your peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please join me now in saying the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, We, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all, for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts, we may show forth your praise not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. And now the prayer of St. Chrysostom. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. And now I invite you to enjoy a collage of the children's pictures, of crafts, featuring such things as this, of games, of toys, of this, and reflections. Goodbye for now.